great pleasure to invite and introduce Dr. Manisha Sethi, who will be speaking on the Shramanic religious traditions of India, largely Jainism and Buddhism. So let me tell you a little bit about Dr. Sethi. Dr. Manisha Sethi is Associate Professor at the Center for Jawaharlal Nehru Studies at Jamia Millia Islamia University in New Delhi. She is a sociologist by training. Her research interests encompass a wide range of subjects, from gender and religion to law and counterterrorism. Her doctoral work was an ethnographic study of the nuns of the Jain tradition, specifically why are there so many women renouncers in Jainism and Jain tradition. And that book, the book that came out of her doctoral work, is called Escaping the World, Women Renouncers Among Jains, which came out by Routledge Press in 2012. Her current work examines the relationship between religion and law. And she has also authored *Andkafkaland, Law, Prejudice and Counterterrorism in India, which is by three essays, which was published in 2014. With that, I invite Dr. Sethi to give us her talk.
Am I audible? Yeah. Thank you very much, Mona, for inviting me here. It's a great pleasure to be here. And also, delighted to be in a place where you actually don't see the air that you're breathing. So I come from the city of the poisoned air. And so you'll have to bear with me because I'll be coughing incessantly throughout the talk. The title of the talk, as Mona said, is a kind of an introduction to Shramanic religions. Now, what exactly are Shramanic religions, or what do we mean by the term Shramanic? Now, when we say Shramanic, it comes from the term Shram, which means to labor or to strive. So they're also called striver religions, strivers. Now, if we talk about, say, the 6th or the 7th century BC Indo-Gangetic plains, we see a range of these traditions. They're also called heterodox traditions. A range of these traditions were flourishing at that time, of which three were the most prominent: Buddhism, Jainism, and what is called, or which disappeared after a while, called the Ajivikas. So these were the three main traditions present, and we're talking about, remember, what is present-day Bihar, eastern, the Indo-Gangetic plain. So you have Buddhism, Jainism, and Ajivikas, which were the most prominent, and over a period of time, say about early Christian era, Ajivikas also disappeared. Some say they were absorbed into the Jains or the Buddhists, or simply disappeared. Now, what do we mean when we say that these are striver religions or Shramanic religions? Now, a classical Shramanic, the classical sort of definition of a Shramanic tradition is that it has three characteristics. The first is that it rejects the authority of the Vedas, right? So you're talking about 6th century, where you're coming to the end of what is called the Vedic period or the Vedic epoch. We'll just come to that in a bit. But the first characteristic of a Shramanic tradition is, so Shramanic can also be seen as a kind of a counter to Brahmanic, right? That it is opposed or counter, opposed to the Brahmanic. So the first characteristic is that it rejects the authority of the Vedas. So along with Vedas, the Brahmanas, the Samhitas, the Dharmashastras, everything that the Brahmanical religion kind of espouses is rejected. All the texts in the scriptures are rejected. The authority of those texts is rejected by the Shramanic tradition. The second is, it does not believe in the efficacy of the ritual of sacrifice. And I will also come to it in greater detail. the idea that performance of a certain ritual or performance of ritual sacrifices could lead to a better birth or whatever, we'll come to that in a moment. So it rejects the efficacy of the ritual, the performance of rituals of, and specifically of the sacrifice. And the third is that it does not believe in the divinity of any of the divine figures that are part of the Brahminical pantheon, whether it's Brahma, Vishnu, Shiv, or any of the various avatars that we find in the 18 Puranas of Hinduism. So it's rejecting the authority of the Vedas. So it's in a sense a complete rejection of whatever Brahminism stands for. Rejecting the key texts of that tradition, rejects the key ritual or the key mode of performance of that tradition, and also rejects the divinity. The Vedic pantheon, whether it's Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, Shiva, etc. So now this is the kind of a classical definition of a Shramanic traditions. And as we will see, the Buddhists, I'm not going to go much into Ajivikas, but Buddhists and Jains fall under this classical definition of a Shramanic tradition. Now, as I said, that these traditions arose in, say, the 6th century BC in the Indo-Gangetic plains. Now, let us look at the kind of the social background that existed at that time, which was the frame in which these traditions originated and flourished. So if we look at, scholars have usually said, delineated a kind of a linear history of the Vedic age or the developments during that period. So the first or the early Vedic age is seen to be from the 15th to 10th century. So in order to understand the kind of a social background in which these traditions originated, let's go back a little bit and try and understand what were the, what led to that period. So we can, according to scholars, we can see a kind of an early Vedic period between, say, 15th to 10th century BC. This can be called the early Vedic period. And this is the period, which is marked by, in economic terms, it's marked by nomadism or pastoralism in terms of economic organization. So it's a very loose, weak sort of economic organization marked by pastoralism or nomadism. There are no large urban centers. And the technology is weakly developed. And this period marks the composition of the Rig Veda. And here you have, the Sanskrit is the spoken language, and the people who are part of the Vedic culture are called the Aryans. Now, and Rig Veda is composed, by the end of it, the Rig Veda has been composed. Okay, thanks. Now, this is the early Vedic period, and the period that follows this, say from the 10th century BC to 6th century BC, is called the late Vedic period. And here you see a kind of a shift from the nomadism or pastoralism to more settled agrarian societies. So you see a perceptible shift. And this itself has great social consequences. The consolidation of economic organization in terms of settled agriculture has great social consequences, because you have a settled agriculture allows for the accumulation of economic surpluses. It creates economic surplus. So, and alongside, you have a rise in technology. You have the, iron starts to be used, weapons are produced, new sort of technology comes into being. And all of this has the effect of creating, in the earlier period, you have a small, tribal brotherhoods. But now you have the formation of the states. So this is a period which, where you have, in terms of economy, you have settled agriculture. There is rise in technology. So you have weapons, iron, the use of iron in, for, you know, agriculture. You have economic surpluses. So when you have economic surplus, it leads to a kind of a formation of, you know, there's more state formation. There are a number of smaller kingdoms that come into being. So say, for example, by 8th century, you have about 16 in the Indo-Gangetic plain, you have about 16 small kingdoms, which kind of consolidate into four kingdoms by the end of, say, 6th century. And by the 5th century, you only have one major kingdom, which is the Magadhan Empire, right? So you have a rise of bureaucratic empires fueled by the economic surpluses generated by a more settled agriculture. So you have so the rise of the bureaucratic empire, and because of the economic surplus, there's more investment into
laying of roads, etc., which allows for a new market is developing. There is rise of the merchant class. People are able to go and, you know, sell and buy goods. So all of this is happening, but and this is also the period, the later Vedic period, which is the composition of the other, you know, the Vedas, you have the Upanishads. So if the Rig Veda was, I mean, I'm also now trying to think about what were the dominant ways of thinking in that period. So if you look at the early Vedic period, which is dominated by the composition of the Rig Veda, which are basically like hymns of praise to various deities of the Vedic pantheon. Right? So you have a hymn dedicated to Indra, you know, the rain god, and various different divinities. Huh? So what basically Rig Veda is, so you're performing, you know, you're praising these gods and seeking favors from them. You're making, you know, you're seeking basically their sort of divine intervention in your life. That's what the Rig Veda is about in one sense. Now in the Upanishads, you may find much more sort of mystical speculation about the relationship between the macrocosm and the man. And it is in the Upanishads, and I'll just come to this, it is in the Upanishads where a theory of sacrifice becomes to be delineated. Now, of course, this is, you know, the idea that the ritual action of sacrifice has some kind of a creative force. It is some kind of a creative force which energizes the universe, which creates, which has great creative potential. For example, the, you know, the story about the, you know, the primeval man, the Purush Sukta, which basically says that the man, the primeval man sacrificed himself because there was nothing else to sacrifice, and out of this emerged, you know, the different classes in society. So it has a kind of a creative potential. Sacrifice has creative potential. So it is in this period by 6th century BC where you have, I mean, this is a rather simplistic kind of a linear understanding of history, because there must have been great periods when the pastoralism must have overlapped with settled agriculture, where the tribal brotherhoods must have overlapped with the emerging empires and so on. And also the fact that Upanishad is not simply a theory of the codes and the symbols from previous writings. So what you have here is, but nonetheless what we can say is that by the 6th century, you had a social situation where there was an increasing consolidation of economic organization. There was the emergence of big empires. There was a rise of technology, the laying of, and a new emerging market, and the rise of a new merchant class. So all of these things were happening in that period.
So when you have a new social organization, you also need new kinds of ideologies to sanctify those new conditions. You need new kinds of ideas to justify those new conditions and to be able to relate to these new conditions. For example, if you look at the Dharma Shastras, there is a kind of a disdain towards city life. So the Shastras always caution men against dwelling for too long in the city, because it's the, you know, it's where, you know, there's something morally corrupt about the city. So the city, and whereas this is the period where, you know, urban centers are growing, cities are growing, but the earlier texts do not allow for that kind of a, you know, ideological justification of living. Trade, right? It says that trade is not one of the good occupations to be had. But here you are in a situation where there is a rising merchant class. So obviously, new kind of you know, ideas are needed, you know, which will allow. And for example, in this, you know, the rising bureaucratic empire needs more and more revenues. But the early because of the fact that in the Brahminical or the Vedic period, the Brahmin was seen as the most important person and they were exempted from taxes. So, you know, that really doesn't work here. Huh? And the fact that from the theory of sacrifice comes the idea that the person who can perform the sacrifice? It's only the Brahmin, right? It is only the Brahmin who can perform the sacrifice. So there is a certain social, in the hierarchy, the Brahmin is of course at the top in this hierarchy, and this comes into conflict with the rising status of the merchant class. You have you know, a merchant who is economically powerful. You have a merchant class which is politically powerful, because, you know, in the rising empire, it is the market which is playing a big role, but their social status is not concomitant with their actual political and economic power. So these traditions, the Shramanic traditions, the Jain, the Buddhist, the Ajivikas, then offered a kind of a theory which suited this rising merchant class, which was a break from these kinds of ideas that were present in, so the influence of the Vedic ideology, which prioritized the Brahmin, which prioritized the ritual of sacrifice as the most important ritual. Now, what does ritual of sacrifice entail actually? Let's look at that. It involves a sacrifice, I mean not always, but mostly involved the killing of animals. Secondly, it needed a priestly class. Somebody's going to conduct the, you and I cannot simply conduct the ritual sacrifice. No? It is, you need a specialized priestly class for conducting that. Then, that involves the praise of divinities, as we said, which comes from the Rig Veda. You know, you're making an offering to the divinity. What is sacrifice? It's an offering to the divinity. And in return, you're asking for favors. Huh? And there is sanctified space, there is specialized language, which is Sanskrit, etc., etc. Now, within these, there are two ideas. One is that sacrifice itself is a means of perpetuating life. That by performance of sacrifice, or by somebody who's sponsoring the performance of sacrifice, you can ensure that, you know, you don't really terminate with this life, that your life can continue and you can be reborn. So the idea of birth and rebirth and extension of life beyond this one life comes into being. And also seen is implicated in this is the emergence of both the universe. So in sacrifice, as I said, you know, the idea of the primeval sacrifice of the primeval man, the idea that somehow within the ritual act, both the universe, the macrocosm and the man, the individual, is implicated. So these ideas were quite central to this, you know, the Vedic ideas of sacrifice. And from these emerged two very central ideas. So as I said, Shramanic traditions offered us something new, but they were not a complete break from the ideas that existed in the past. From these ideas which emerged from, you know, the Vedic ritual, extended active Vedic ritual and so on, there were two ideas that emerged. The first was the idea of birth and rebirth, the idea of samsara. Samsara doesn't just mean the world. You know, you can't translate simply as the world, but really as the continuous process of birth and rebirth. So from these emerged the idea of, so this is emerging from the idea of sacrifice, that it is possible to extend one's life, that it is possible to be reborn. So this becomes a kind of a key concept which is then worked upon by these Tamil traditions. And secondly, the idea of karma, which can mean action, which can mean ritual action. The idea that the performance of the ritual action can lead to rebirth. So that the idea that action has consequences, right? Whether in this birth or in the next, action has consequences. The idea of karma emerges from, so this is the second central idea which is developed from the idea of the correct performance of the sacrifice. So, now both these ideas of samsara and karma were taken, and in a way one can look at all Eastern traditions and say that it is fundamentally about, you know, these two ideas of samsara and karma. Now both of these ideas were taken, but they were tweaked in a way that marked its distance from the existing ideas, that gave legitimacy to these newly emerging classes which were becoming socially and economically and politically powerful, but at the same time it didn't mark a very clear break, because you know the idea of sacrifice, for example, was very, very prevalent, all pervasive, right? So it didn't, you didn't really, so for example, let's say in the case of, and as we see both Buddhism and Jainism, and we come to this, propounded the idea of ahimsa, non-violence, right? So in a way, sacrifice itself, which involved not always but most of the times the actual killing of animals, was seen as wrong by Buddhism and Jainism, right? Because the idea of ahimsa says non-violence, you shall not kill, basically. So, but because the idea of sacrifice itself was so important in this period, it wasn't simply, you know, abandon. What Jains did was to turn it inwards. So the, you know, for example, the fire which is lit in the sacrifice was said to be turned inwards. So the austerities that you perform, we come to this, I'll explain that in greater detail later. So the austerities that you perform are like fire. You're burning away, you know, the karma inside. So it is turned inwards, but it doesn't, so, you know, the idea of sacrifice remains, but it is given, it is more internalized. It is given a kind of an internal frame rather than actual external performance of a sacrifice. Now, so coming back to this idea of shram. Now, if you say that the you know, performance of ritual is really not effective, once you have this idea, it means that, and who can perform? Only the Brahmin can perform. So the idea that only some people are entitled to performance of ritual action, and so therefore they are the only ones entitled to, you know, extension, or, and they're the only ones who can perform the good acts, that gets taken away when you deny the efficacy of ritual action. When you say that it doesn't really matter, that sacrifice is actually just a bloody waste of time. It's sheer nonsense, it doesn't really help. When you propound that idea, it opens up the doors of salvation to everybody. Right? It's not just the priestly class which will mediate your, you know, relationship with samsara and karma, but everybody can strive, you know, the term striver, everybody can strive to attain salvation. It's not simply the performance of sacrifice which is restricted to certain groups, certain elite groups, but it opens up the doors to a whole range of people. So, and the idea of purity and pollution also gets weakened, which was very much a central idea of, I think we will have the discussion on caste later, but the idea of ritual purity and pollution, which was quite central to caste. So therefore you have, you know, injunctions against trading, because trading will take you to, you know, far away from home, you will be dealing with people of all kinds. Now these ideas of ritual purity and pollution are weakened when you say that, you know, there is no efficacy to sacrifice and that anybody can attain salvation. It's not simply those who are born into the Brahmin caste or those who are born in the upper caste who have access to salvation. So these ideas then become, of course, very attractive to certain groups who have hitherto been pushed out of the, you know, the Brahmin elite. Now these ideas, as I said, were taken, the idea of samsara, karma, etc., were taken, but tweaked and chiseled in a manner that was both different and had some continuities with the existing ideas. Now let's first look at very quickly at Buddhism, and then very quickly at Jainism, and then if there's time, then we look at what the consequences of these ideas are for the question of gender, but that's if we have time for that. Now, Buddhism and Jain, now, you know, people who are outside of these traditions, and especially, you know, modern Western historiography of both Jainism and Buddhism tends to see Buddha as the founder of Buddhism, right? And Mahavir as the founder of Jainism. But if you take a more internal sort of view, for them, the universe, the world has always existed. Time is eternal. There is no, you know, there is no starting point, there is no end point. And from time to time, there will arise these great men who will propound the teachings. Now the teachings, so it's not that they are propounding something new, but these are older teachings which are being propounded by these great teachers to the world every time. Now, in that sense, neither Buddha nor Mahavir are divine beings. They're not gods. They're not gods. Though they are taken in ordinary layman terms as very saintly teachers. They have near divine characteristics, but they're never really God in the sense that we understand. But they're not the creator God, right? They're not divinities. So they are human teachers in a way. They are human teachers who arise from time to time to teach the true path of salvation. Now, if you talk about Buddhism, it's fairly, you know, very simply somebody who takes refuge in the three refuges. First is anybody who believes in Buddha, Sangha, and Dhamma. These three are the central sort of Buddha is, I mean, it's a paradigmatic figure, but I mean, not, of course, in the most recent times, the Buddhists would say it is the Gautam Buddha which is nearer to our times, so he's remembered, huh? But Buddha is really, you know, it's a kind of a paradigm for a human teacher who teaches the path of salvation. Dhamma is the truth, so it's Dhamma is, not to be translated simply as religion, but it is both the law and the truth. So it's more descriptive. This is what the Buddha preaches. Dhamma is what the Buddha preaches, and in a sense, it's both prescriptive and descriptive. So it's both the law It's prescribing, right? This is how you have to live your life. So it's prescriptive, it's law, but it's also the truth. It is the teaching of the truth. And the Sangha, I mean, in ordinary terms, Sangha means three, those who have been ordained as Buddhists. The community of followers, but it usually means those who have been ordained as monks. Now, when I'm not going to go into the biography of Buddha or not Mahavir. If you're interested, I can give you the readings for that. Now, Buddha is said to have preached that this first sermon was at Sarnath, and his first sermon is said to have propounded what is called the middle path. Now, Buddhism is identified closely with what is called the middle path. Now, what do we mean by the middle path? That is neither attachment to sensual pleasure and indulgences, nor extreme austerities. So it's really the middle path, which is given to neither extremes, neither sensuality nor extreme austerity. Now this middle path is said to have been derived from Buddha's own experience. So the story goes that when Buddha renounced the world, he wandered around looking for the truth. Now the first, he chanced upon two spiritual teachers who taught him how to get into these great ecstatic trances. Now, although he enjoyed these ecstatic trances very much, he thought that this wasn't really revealing to him the truth. His quest for truth didn't end with these ecstatic trances. So then he abandoned these two spiritual teachers and moved on and came to become the disciple of these five monks. Now, these five monks taught him great austerity. You know, you had to fast for long periods. You have to subject yourself to all kinds of, you know, physical and mental vexations and so on. Now, Gautam thought that this was only leading to starvation and not leading to truth. So he abandoned him, these five men as well, and then he started to eat in moderation and to meditate. And this is when, you know, Eureka happens and he discovers the truth. So it is the middle path, neither extreme, you know, ecstasy of sensual pleasures, nor extreme austerities. Now, when we, you know, and he's talking really of practices, practice of the Buddhist path. Now, if we look at attachment to sensual pleasures, it's identified most closely with the Brahminical ideology, the householder, somebody who's supposed to live through life as a householder, bring up children, marry, undertake all kinds of worldly activities and so on, right? So the path of attachment to sensual pleasures has been, there's a term that Buddha uses for it, which is pronounced as gamma, G-A-M-M-A. Now gamma has these various connotations. It means, on the one hand, village or rustic, which is like crude, rustic person. It also has the connotation of sexual intercourse. So these are the different kinds of connotations that it has. So we know that, for example, that Buddha or the social class that followed Buddhism initially was urban mercantile class. And so you have here the kind of dismissal of the attachment to sensual pleasures as gamma, which is identified with crude rusticness, but also with sexual intercourse and so on. So this was to be eschewed, this path was to be eschewed. The other path, of course, is the path of extreme austerity that will come to Jains in a moment, which was promoted by them. So neither of these two extremes was to be followed in the pursuit of truth. It was the middle path, right, of restraint, but reasonable restraint, not the extreme austerities that, for example, the Jains undertake of prodigious long fasting and so on. That was to be not the path of the Buddha. Now, after this, he of course gave propounded the Four Noble Truths. So Buddhism is a very, very stronger view of reality. You know, the idea of dukkha or suffering, which is translated as suffering, but it's not such a precise translation. It means that you are unsatisfied. The world is not such a great place to live in. You know, that realization that the world is pervaded by dukkha, right? And the root of dukkha or suffering is desire. Because I desire something and I cannot get it, leads to frustration and so on. Right? So the four that's the second noble truth, that is the heart of dukkha is desire. And the third is that it is possible to for us to stop desire, right? That it's possible, and the way to do it through the eightfold path that he lays out. And so these are the four noble truths. That so the world is a world of suffering, but it's possible to get out of it, right? So very different. So you see that the burden of coming out of this world of suffering lies with us, right? Not through the ritual action of sacrifice. But it is a very sad, what can be called religious individualism, that it is up to the individual alone to realize that the desires are nothing, that you should abandon those desires and so on. So the eightfold path, the cultivation of right view, right knowledge, the right metaphysical view, right meditation and so on. So it is the individual is burdened with undertaking all of that. It is not divine grace. So God is not going to smile at us one day and say, okay, you've been a good boy and I'm going to grant you salvation. Right? So that is not going to happen. It is within us, for us to decide whether we want to turn away from false views towards the correct view. Now, if we look at the way in which Buddhism sort of lays out the theory of phenomenal existence, we can see that there are three sort of elements to it. One is the idea that everything is impermanent. Right? Everything is in a state of flux, nothing is permanent. Now this of course goes right at the heart of the grammatical idea of eternal immutability, that Atma is eternal, right? The soul is eternal, it's always there. It is immutable, it is eternal, right? So it was offering a kind of a counter to that. So nothing is permanent, everything is in a state of flux. And secondly, that there is no essence, there is no Atma, there is no soul. Theory of non-soulism, there is no soul. We are not, when I say me, I'm made of my body, I'm made of my consciousness, I'm made of my perceptions, I'm made of my feelings, my volitions, right? There are these four or five things, but there is no something which can be grasped as soul, right? So everything is impermanent, and I'm just at this moment, it's like a program, right? It's kind of this combination is there, but it's going to end one day, right? So there is there is impermanence, there is no soul, and there is constant suffering, there is dukkha. So these are the three kind of things that you can understand as belonging to the heart of Buddhism, the theory of phenomenal existence. And the way out of this, as I said, was the following of the eightfold path. And it is up to us to understand, to realize this is the truth, that there is nothing permanent, everything is a state of flux, that the world is full of suffering, which comes from our desire, and that there is no essence or soul, right? So this is the true realization. This is when enlightenment happens, when you realize this, you know? And you turn away from desires. And so when you have no ego, when you have no soul, right, there is no, the idea that there is no soul also leads to the idea that there is no self, there is no ego, right? So from these emerge two very important ideas of Buddhism, which is the idea of compassion or karuna, which was a very and the idea of ahimsa, non-violence. So both the idea of compassion and karuna actually offer a kind of an antidote to the kind of social exploitation that was the order of the day, with the Brahmins at the top, and a kind of an ideological justification of the hierarchy. So karuna and compassion come out of these ideas of non-solism, impermanence, etc., etc. Now I'm going to quickly rush to the ideas of Jainism. As I said, neither the Jains would not consider Mahavir as the founder of, for them he is only the last of the teachers of this era, right? There were 24 Tirthankars or, okay, so Jains are those who follow, I mean very simply, disciples or followers of the Jina. Now Jina literally translates as spiritual victors, no? Those who've conquered all their desires, all their, you know, lust, greed, hatred, jealousy, whatever it may be. So those who conquered this. Now, the Jina was, as I was saying, there were many, many heterodox sects in 6th century in the Catholic faith. So Jina was a term which was regularly employed by many of these categories. But when the Ajivikas kind of disappeared, the category of Jina came to be monopolized by what are called the present day Jains. So prior to that, the followers of Jina were called, simply called the Nirgrantas or the morning response. Now, so according to the Jains, as I said, their time is kind of eternal and timeless, but they think of time in terms of cycles. So every cycle, there is a progressive cycle and a regressive half cycle. And in every half cycle, it's very complicated. I don't want to get into too many technical details. If anybody is interested, we can discuss it later. But the idea is that in every half cycle, there arise 24 Tirthankars. The Tirthankars are basically Tirthankar, the literal translation is makers of the ford. That is, those who build bridges across this ocean of suffering, right? Who lead us through this ocean of suffering. Now, so the Jain, I believe, is that in every half cycle there arise 24 Tirthankars, and in this half cycle there have already arisen 24 Tirthankars. Mahavir was the last of them, so there is going to be no, in fact, there's going to be no more salvation. Not just Tirthankars, but no more salvation in this era. So again, the Tirthankars or the Jinas are human teachers, but endowed with some sort of semi-divine characteristics much later. But theoretically, they're supposed to be simply human teachers who propounded the path of truth. Now, I'm very quickly go over its idea of theory of existence, which will give you an idea how markedly different it was from the Brahmanical ideas. Now, Jainism believes that there are three kinds of existence. Everything that exists is of either of these three categories. The first is you have the sentient. Beings which are sentient, those existences which are sentient, which have consciousness, those which are non-sentient, that is, those that lack consciousness, and the third is those that are neither sentient nor non-sentient. Now, very quickly, what is sentient? Sentient is basically that which has consciousness, meaning it is, by sentient they mean the soul, right? Now, we saw that the Buddhists dismissed the possibility of a soul, right? That there was no soul, there was no essence. But the Jains don't do that. The Jains cling on to the idea of the soul, right? The soul has several qualities. It has consciousness, it has energy, and it can experience bliss or sukh. So it's got these three sort of main characteristics, which is consciousness, ability to see, perceive, apprehend, comprehend. And so obviously all souls have different levels of consciousness. We are all, of course, reeling under delusions and false beliefs, right? It's only the jinas, which are those who have gained enlightenment, that have understood the true nature of who attained omniscience, right, or perfect knowledge. Others are harboring under false beliefs, delusions, and so on and so forth. So, and then there is the quality of sukh or bliss, and bliss doesn't, it's not the bliss that you derive from buying new clothes or, you know, watching a nice movie, but it's the bliss of the soul, which is, you know, it's a different category, different kind of a sukh. The third is energy, that is which energizes both of these principles. So, by sentient existence, basically the Jains mean that there exists a soul. We all have souls, right? Now, even the plants and animals have souls. Everything that exists as consciousness has soul. Even the microscopic beings, you know, very microbial beings have souls, right? So, and there is no difference between their souls and ours. There may be difference of, you know, we may be five sense, they may be one sense, but in the sense, everybody has soul. So in a sense, there is a great equality in the universe, right? That everybody has a soul, which is actually very similar. It's everybody's soul has these three qualities of consciousness, energy, and bliss. There is no difference between, so therefore, the ideas of ahimsa, etc., come, right? That I have no right to kill even a little microscopic being, because that too has soul, just like I do. Now, so the non-sentient is of course, it's matter. When they talk about non-sentient existence, it basically means matter like this wood, for example. Now, and it's basically like the different atoms coming together and forming a formation. So, and the third category, which is neither sentient nor non-sentient, is time and space. Now, I'm not going to go into great details except that space is important, because it is the locus where all the drama and action is happening. So they tend to imagine space, which is called the Lok Akash, as a kind of a, you know, anybody's looked at any Jain paintings at the museum, you might see something there. All of these ideas are presented very graphically in Jain art. So the Jain universe is actually described as a kind of a man, you know, a man standing with his arms apart. That is the kind of graphic representation of the universe. And it's important. I'll just say it's important. So the idea is that this is the kind of idea of the Jain universe. So here is, there are seven heavens, then there are seven hells, and this middle world is the Madhya Loka, which is the middle world, and it's made up of, you know, concentric circles of islands, each divided by, you know, huge mountains and deep seas and so on and so forth. But the one point is that it is only the central continent, which is the Jambudvip, which is the location of, which is called the Karma Bhumi. This is where all the action is happening. Only humans are born only in this central island, right? You can't be born, you know, you can be hell beings, you can be heavenly beings, but none of you can aspire to salvation. It's only when you're born as a human that you can aspire for salvation. That's the only time when, you know, your soul can experience perfect bliss, perfect consciousness, perfect energy. So it is only when you're, so immediately the consequences, you remember the consequences of this, the idea that being born a human being makes you capable of trying to attain moksha, right? It is capability. So every soul has capability, and which can only be realized when you're born a human. And then there are no distinctions between humans in that sense, right? Because all souls are equal. So it is only when you are born as a human being in this central... So really the action of karma is happening in this island. So, and in that sense, there are four kinds of, we're talking about sentient beings, there are four different categories of sentient beings, which is heavenly, you know, gods, but not in the sense of gods as creator gods or anything, just heavenly, those who reside in the heavens. Then there are hell beings, those who are born as narakis or hellish beings, those that are born as human beings, and the fourth category is those who are born as either plants or animals. So there are four gatis or four destinies. So basically, sansar or rebirth and birth is like an endless cycle where the soul is born and reborn and reborn and reborn. Right? So today we are all humans, and this is possibly the only chance we have of attaining salvation. But depending on what our actions are, we may be reborn as any of the four destinies. We may be reborn as microscopic beings. You may be reborn as some kinds of animals, five sense animals, two sense animals, three sense animals. You may be born as plants. We may be born as hell beings, and you may be born as heavenly beings. Right? You may be born as anything. And this again is very graphically represented in. So these are the four, you know, destinies. And this is really in when Jains perform you know, worship, this is a kind of symbol which is always made. And this kind of graffiti represents the unending cycle of birth and rebirth and the need to escape. So anyway, this is where all the action is happening. Now, when we tend to think of karma, now we tend to think of it as action, right? Or residues of action, right? The traces which action leaves behind, and which then have consequences. Now the Jains again took the idea of karma, but gave a very different twist to it. For the Jains, the karma wasn't simply residues of action or traces of action. Karma was actual matter. It was actually, you know, material. So, the way in which the mechanism of bondage is explained is that there is a soul, right? And we said that the soul has these three qualities, the, you know, consciousness, bliss, and energy. And there is all this karmic matter, you know, karmic matter is supposed to fill in the entire universe. It's present everywhere. Now, it interacts with the soul and produces different kinds of karmas, which keep us in a state of embodiment. Now, for example, let's say the soul has, as I said, it has certain energy. Now, usually the energy is perverted because of, you know, if I'm going to, you know, go out and have ice cream, that's an act of volition, right? But my desire to have ice cream is going to attract a lot of karmic matter, right? And that will then interact with my soul and produce different kinds of karmas. So different kinds of volitional activities and the intensity of feelings behind those volitional activities. For example, if I were to, when I go to class, I don't teach well enough and I try to keep knowledge from my students, then that's going to create you know, a consequence which will lead to obscuring of my own knowledge. That's the idea. That the kinds of feelings, the intensity of feelings, the length of feelings produce, you know, create a situation where the influx of karma happens. Right? So you have a soul, I mean, it's very technical, but the Jains are obsessed with these sort of technical details about the nature of soul. There's a whole lot of literature about what is the nature of soul, you know. Is it a small thing? Is it a large thing? Is it like a cloth which can be folded? Is it like a light which can be shown in a room? So there's a lot of discussion on that. So now, for example, just let's take, this is the soul, and then there's all this karmic matter, right? There's karmic matter around all of us. And depending on our volitional activities, there is an influx of karmic matter. So it's like a, you know, think of, for example, a mirror and a lot of dust floating around it, right? Now, the mirror, the dust will settle on the mirror. Now, if the mirror is slightly damp, the dust will cling to it, right? If it's damp, I mean, the idea is that feelings moisten the soul. That my feelings of desire, lust, greed, hatred, jealousy, any of these, then they moisten the soul. And when the karmic influx happens, the dust, or the karmic dust in a way, settles on the soul, right? And it obscures the soul. So you will have a mirror where you can't see anything because there's dust all over it. The soul, a soul which is moistened by passions of different kinds, is like that mirror which is obscured by dust, right? So again, it is only, I mean, this is very briefly the way in which the mechanism of bondage happens, huh? And so depending on what your intensity of feelings is, the amount of dust that will settle. And if it's totally obscure, then you're condemned, you'll be born probably a microscopic being or a hellish being or whatever, right? It's your best bet, because in this era there is no possibility of salvation. Your best bet is to be continue to be reborn as humans. So that is the only destiny in which salvation is possible at all. Now, so the idea here is that this kind of theory of bondage, which, and also that soul is not simply the cause of embodiment of bondage, it is also the way to freedom, right? All souls have the capacity to overcome passions which bond, which create the karmic influx and allow for the repelling of that karmic matter. So it is the soul which is responsible for bondage, but it is also the soul which is responsible for, which has the capacity to overcome this and lead to salvation, right? To move from the false views to the right views. Now, so this is, so this kind of theory, so it allows for, or it in fact makes very central the idea of soul, unlike Buddhism, which rejects it, but like Brahmanism, which sees the soul as eternal, it sees the soul as eternal, right? But the fact that soul has these qualities which are always changing, depending on my, you know, my nature, my feelings, the intensity of passions. So there is, the soul is never in a state of permanence. So you see the kind of ideas, A, it is eternal, right? It is eternal, like the Brahmins say, but its modes are always in flux, right? Unlike the Buddhists who say that everything is in a flux, there is nothing permanent, right? But unlike the Brahmins who say that it is always eternal, it is immutable. Right, eternal immutability. So here you have a theory which combines kind of both, or rejects both, depending on how you look at it. And so you have the idea of a soul which is permanent, but at the same time which is constantly changing, because its qualities are constantly changing. The bliss, the level of bliss is never the same. The level of energy is never the same. The level of consciousness is never the same. It's always changing. So you have the theory which is both, which looks at soul as both permanent, but at the same time not immutable. Now the Jains, there is a term which is often used, which is, sayadva, which is called a kind of pre-modern postmodernism. Now, this has the idea that it's a kind of way of thinking about things. Now, the Jains would say that, okay, we're not saying that the Brahmins are all wrong. Okay, they believe in the idea of eternal soul, we agree to that. So, but theirs is a partial view, because they do not recognize that though the soul is eternal, its modes are constantly changing, right? Now, similarly, they would say to the Buddhists that, okay, we agree that, you know, there is a state of impermanence always, but you have to recognize that there is a permanent essence, what is the soul, right? So they would reject both as partial views, not as really false views, but as partial views, right? So, and instead they say that when we make a claim about something, we must qualify it. We must say that it is so in this respect, but so in that respect. So the soul is permanent, eternal in some respects, but impermanent and flux in other respects. This is called what is called Sayadva, right? The idea that there is no one partial truth and that you will always have to qualify any assertion that you are making. And it's often referred to as a kind of an intellectual ahimsa, that you're not condemning any view as, you know, false. Although, I mean, we can discuss about whether it's, should be called intellectual ahimsa or not. So, I have 5 minutes. So these would be, I just wanted to say that, you know, we're thinking of, I don't want to, I mean, I'm not so much a student of Buddhism, but when we talk about Jainism, I don't want to go away with the impression that there is one Jainism, right? There are many, many distinctions between Jainism, and even on many of the doctrinal questions, although the idea of mechanism of bondage is shared by different groups, there are many fundamental differences between different groups of Jains, which we can also call sectarian differences. For example, in I mean, according to the number sources, the story is that so there are these two groups of Jains. Mainly, the principal schism is between the Shvetambars, that is, those white clad, whose monks and nuns wear white, and the Digambars, that is, the sky clad, those who go without clothes. Now, there are a lot of differences in terms even of the biography of Mahavir. There are certain episodes which the Digambars discredit, which the Shvetambars insist upon, and so on and so forth, right? But there are three main differences, and I'll just end with that. There are three main sort of key differences between the Shvetambars and the Digambars. First is on the idea of nudity. As I said, the Digambars are sky-clad. Now for them, because, you know, the five great vows, when you enter into renunciation, see, the idea is that the burden of salvation is all yours. Huh? And so the less the action, the less the volitional activities, the less the karmic influx. So it is best that you eject from the household, huh? That you become renouncers, right? Now, and there are five vows involved in becoming a renouncer, and many of those, but one of them is aparigraha, which is non-possession, that you should not possess anything. Any attachment to anything that you possess immediately means that there is more karmic influx, and, you know, it leads you continuously to keep you in a state of embodiment and bondage. Now, the Gambars insist that even the wearing of clothes is possession, right? And the Shvetambars say that it is wearing of clothes is fine, there's no problem with it, it's just that you shouldn't be attached to the clothes. So, this is the first key difference between them. The Shvetambars saying that nudity is not the prerequisite to renunciation and salvation, the numbers insisting on it. Second, which follows very closely from it, is the question of women's salvation. Now, as we said, the idea is that everybody's got soul, and everybody's got, like, soul with the same qualities. So how can you have a gendered soul, right? If my soul has the capacity to undertake salvation, then surely her does, his does, everybody's does, right? And so also the idea of caste, but I'm going to just discuss the idea of gender, which is that anybody's soul is capable of undertaking the practices of austerities, which is necessary for salvation. Now, if, however, nudity becomes the prerequisite for austerities and salvation, then obviously women cannot renounce their clothes, and so therefore women cannot be complete or, you know, at par with male renouncers, because, you know, and so the Digambars, though they recognize that, you know, in their monastic hierarchy there are women, but they are seen as kind of pseudo, they are just seen as advanced lay women, not really as true ascetics, huh? They're not seen as advanced spiritual, they're seen as advanced spiritual women, but not as complete ascetics. Whereas Shvetambars would dismiss the possibility of nudity as being central to renunciation, allow for the possibility of women attaining salvation. And they have many women. In fact, if you look at the earliest sources, like the Kalpa Sutra, etc., which was one of the earliest belongs to the earliest pattern of canonical literature. The Kalpasutra says that when Mahavir founded his Sangha, there were twice as many women in the lay Sangha, and in the monastic orders there were 2.5 times women. So obviously the Jain monastic order was open to women from the earliest times, and this continues till today. If you look at the census of monastics currently, then the women far outstrip men. So anyhow, so the third, which we can discuss later, but I was just saying that this is how we can discuss. Yes, we can.